of Grace Summit. It is a joy to be here this morning. I have missed so much lately with this, that, and the other, and the weather, and it is just great to be back. So I want to welcome you and to say, if you're visiting with us, we are so thankful you're here. And if you would fill out the little visitor's form in your car, in your pew there in front of you, that would be great. Or you can text hi to us if you're online to the number 636-742-1011. Or you can just hit the like or the comment column on the live stream. There's a few announcements, not a whole lot. On Wednesday, January 26th, the business meeting will be here at 6:30. It is a quarterly business meeting, so we don't have them every month. So quarterly business meeting, January 26th. And then on Tuesday, February the 10th, my twin's birthday, we will have a blood drive here in the fellowship hall from 2 to 6. That will have more information to come following. Not everything is really tweaked good with that, but that will be coming up too. So have a great day.
Thanks, Debbie. Let's pray. It is Baptist Men's Day, and so we have our fellows. Don't they look great? Doesn't that look great? Yeah. So we're going to sing some songs, some familiar ones to you, so that you can help us sing as well, right? So it'll be good. Let's pray together. We'll have our prelude. That's a great time for us to still our hearts before God and prepare ourselves for worship. And then we'll honor him in song and hear today's message. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the blessings that you give us. Father, we pray for these announcements, Lord, and we pray for this blood drive that is being planned. And we pray, Lord, that it might be a great way for our building to be used to just bless the community and meet a need. Lord, and we thank you for our medical staff, Lord, that are working so hard. And Lord, many of them are just kind of at the cusp of burnout. And we always pray that they would receive a special blessing and a special boost of endurance as they work so hard in what they do. Father, help us as we sing to you, Lord. Help our praise to be a sweet offering unto you. And as we hear your word, we pray that you would give us ears to hear, eyes to see the truth that you have for us, that you would help us to live out your truth and be more like Jesus today than we were yesterday. Do that in us, that you would be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's hear the prelude together. Fellas, we're in hymn 255. I'd invite you to stand with us to sing. And if you'd like to turn with us in your hymnal, we're in hymn number 255. If not, we're going to see the words on the screen. Let's sing together, At the Cross.
All right, guys. Alas, indeed.
Intro. All right, guys.
But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do.
Amen.
At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
All right, let's turn to 304, Crown Him with Many Crowns. Have you guys noticed our great little addition here? Isn't that great? There you go. You guys are superb. Let's sing together, Crown Him with Many Crowns, number 304.
Fair flowers of peace.
Let's skip over to hymn 98, fellas. That's a big turn. Hymn 98. Come the Fount says, here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above, because we are prone to wander, because all of us fall short of the glory of God. None of us have arrived yet. We pray that the Lord might take us and might help us and might persevere us in the faith. I love this song. It's one of my favorite hymns. And so I hope that you will sing it out with us. Come Thou Fount, hymn 98. Let's sing it together.
Come Thou Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home.
Sing this.
Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood.
Amen.
Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace, Lord, like a fetter bind my wandering heart to prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for my courts above.
And turn over to hymn 83 as we sing, Be Thou My Vision. I feel like this is a, I feel like ladies can sing this too, but I feel like this was a great song for Baptist Men's Day. It's a masculine song in a way, but it's a song that is so beautiful and poignant in its praise to God. And so it's applicable to all. Let's sing hymn 83, Be Thou My Vision. Wisdom.
Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord.
Riches
I need not, Lord, and since he prayed.
High King of Heaven.
High King of Heaven, I victory won. May I reach heaven's joys, O bright heaven's sun.
Sing this. Thank you, guys. Thank you, men, for singing with us. I need to say this more than once a year, but thank you, Barb, for doing everything that she did. She is not a Baptist man, but she is here, and she serves faithfully. So, hey, as our ushers come, we're going to transition. You guys are free to go ahead. And some of you guys probably are the ushers. God bless you guys. As the ushers come, we're going to draw near to our time of offering. If you're visiting with us or you're watching for the first time, we're thankful that you're here and thankful for you just to be our visitor today. But we give with our ushers. We also give through tithing. That's how Sarah and I tithe. And we invite you, if the Lord so chooses to lead you in that direction, you can utilize that as well. It's a good tool. But I'm going to pray, and then we're going to take up that, and then we're going to continue on with our service. Father, we thank you, Lord. Would you be our vision today? Would you be the thing that we set our eyes upon? To look to Jesus, the founder, the finisher of our faith, the one who went before us, who endured a cruel cross, but has risen and sits at the right hand of the Father. And we thank you, Lord, that you love us and intercede for us even still. Until the day that you will come and make all things new. So, Father, as we drop our offering, let it too be an extension of our worship. Lord, there's no way to repay what you've done for us. But, Lord, we gather together to join in a mission, to be the light unto others. Father, we pray for men, Lord, to rally up their families and to lead in singing. And to lead in declaring that you are the Lord. And, Father, let it resound. Because, Father, it is so important that when men lead the charge, Father, wonderful things happen. Lord, we thank you for all of our folks, all of our people, and all that they do. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Kids are dismissed to Children's Church. You go on ahead. Be good. Behave yourselves. I know you will. It's a good group of kids. Crazy, crazy. While back, I read an internet article that just kind of, I thought was interesting. I get interested in things like this, and I'm not sure why. Maybe that's not your fancy, but I just kind of get fascinated by stuff like this. I looked up an article that said the most typecast movie stars. You know what the word typecast mean? Anybody ever heard that? It's whenever a performer is repeatedly cast in the same sort of role, pattern after their previous success. They're kind of fit in there. So the number one typecast movie star they think of all time was John Wayne, right? Because John Wayne just played John Wayne in every movie. He was the all-American cowboy. He was this cowboy grit guy. But even in the World War II movies that he played in, he was still kind of the cowboy, right? I mean, he was just John Wayne, except in World War II. You know, that's just what he did. The runners-up were Morgan Freeman. He's kind of this wise, sage-like man that he plays. Sometimes he plays God, you know, in different things. He's got that voice. No one's got a voice like Morgan Freeman. Christopher Walken is always kind of crazy. You know, that's kind of what he is. Jack Nicholson, same deal, just kind of a crazy guy. Have you ever been typecast, though? Do you think you've been typecast? And what I mean by that, you say, I've never played in a movie in my life. But has someone made an assumption about you and tried to peg you in with their perception of you? And perhaps maybe we even, if you allow me to stretch the metaphor, maybe we even typecast other people into roles. And we treat them or mistreat them accordingly. We believe something about somebody just because of what is on the face value, just what's on the outside. And I have a couple personal stories, of course, like I always do. And whenever I tell those, I'm not trying to make myself the hero or the victim of anything. I'm just trying to teach you all and share a time in the Word together. But when I was a teenager, I looked the part of a slacker. I just looked the part. I wore my hair very long. I wore tore up clothes. I looked like the kid that didn't care. And when people saw me, well, they treated me like the kid that didn't care. And I think sometimes, maybe even in an unfair way. Now, I earned some of that reputation for sure. I had walked myself into that. I thought that I was Kurt Cobain. Some of y'all don't know who that is. But I thought I was that guy, this guy that doesn't care, and I'm kind of sticking it to the man. I was this dude. But from teachers to bosses, even when I tried my best, I was still the guy that didn't care. Still treated like the guy who wasn't good enough. And I could compare that to one of my best friends. He was one of my groomsmen in my wedding in high school. And well, we got married outside of high school, but he was one of my best friends in high school. And he was a cat's kid. That was what we called the kind of gifted program. And he would brag to us. I mean, really brag to us that he said, I had an oral report today. I had to go up and present. I didn't do any of it, but I got up there and he shot that smile. He was tall. He had dark hair. He had a great smile. He would just shoot that smile and he would go. And he would just talk about whatever topic that was given to him. And that dude would get an A every single time. Every time. I'm not even joking. What did he have? He had the reputation of being the genius kid. Which, if only all of us could be so lucky, right? As Christians, we can actually damage the mission of the church when we typecast people based on this kind of surface level assumptions and presumptions about them and treating them accordingly. We end up showing a sort of kind of ungodly favoritism that doesn't match the way of Jesus. And that's what today's scripture is about. We've been in a series through the book of James, and today's scripture is about typecasting one another by looking not at the heart but at the face and treating people accordingly. And so I want to look at the scripture together, then I want to look at the Savior together. And so if you would, we're in James chapter 2. If you have your copy of God's Word, I hope you do. James chapter 2, hope you're following along with us, even if you're at home today. Lots of people, you know, I don't even need to say it. So lots of people doing what they got to do. So if you're at home watching, we're glad that I don't see you guys until after we're done. But hope you guys are following along too with an iPad or an iPhone or a Bible, paper Bible. Those never fail, right? So we've been in a series called Faith in Motion because the Christian life isn't just about having faith, which is great, but it's about a faith that works. We aren't saved by works, but we're saved for works. We're saved to do something with our faith. So James moves from subject to subject, showing different areas where our lifestyle should match our faith. And so I want to see an example of that in James chapter 2, starting at verse 1. So if you found that, I'd invite you to stand again with us as we read the scripture together. He says, in my translation, this thing is bothering me. Verse 1, my brothers and sisters, do not show favoritism as you hold on to the faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe your translation says partiality, something like that. For if someone, what's an example of that? What does that look like in the church? He gives an example. For if someone comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and dressed in fine clothes, and a poor person dressed in filthy clothes also comes in, if you look with favor on the one wearing the fine clothes and saying, sit here in a good place, You know, we got pews marked out. We got the VIP section ready for the people we really love and really care for. But then you say to the poor person, stand over there. Or sit there on the floor by my footstool. You know, you can sit where I put up my feet, my dirty feet. Haven't you made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my brothers and sisters, didn't God choose the poor in this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom that he promised to those who love him? Yet you have dishonored the poor. Don't the rich oppress you and drag you into court? That was particular to their context, the context that this was written in. Verse 7, don't they blaspheme the good name that was invoked over you? Verse 8, indeed, if you fulfill the royal law prescribed in the scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing well. If, however, you show a favoritism, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the entire law and yet stumbles at one point is guilty of breaking it all. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. So if you do not commit adultery, but you murder, you're still a lawbreaker. Speak and act as those who are to be judged by the law of freedom. For judgment is without mercy to the one who has not shown mercy. But mercy triumphs over judgment. Let's pray together. Father, we need your help today, as always. We need your spirit here. Oh Lord, you said in your word, when two or three are gathered together, you're already here with us. So we don't need to so much pray that you would be here. We pray that you would just work among us, because you're already among your churches today. Father, do a powerful work in our life. Do a powerful work in my life as we bow our knee, as we humble our heart to your word again, to hear what it has to say. Help us to have it illuminated to our spirits, and give us the strength, our hands and feet, to live it out in our life. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and take a seat. I need to say this at least once a year, that I write my sermon several weeks in advance. And so anytime you hear something and go, wow, what was up with the timing of that? You should know that I write these several weeks in advance. And that I get them to Carol that week, and we put PowerPoints and we put bulletins together, and we do all these things around these sermons. So if anything that I say ever feels pointed at you, that's on God, all right? So just and me too. If it's ever pointed at me, it's on God, okay? And so God is sovereign, right? God is in control. I think God can order things in any way that he wants. And so I just let that ride. I just try to preach the word, okay? So I've titled this message Typecasted, as I've said. And here's our big idea, that Christians don't show partiality. There was evidence in the context that there was sort of like a class warfare between these Jewish believers, between the ones that were rich and the ones that were poor, the ones that owned land and the ones that didn't own land. And it showed up in the way that people were treated, even in their worship gatherings. And so today, here's our outline as we look at this scripture together. We'll see three tests that partiality fails every time. Three tests that it fails. So why we should take this seriously. We can look at step by step how James exposes how damaging partiality is. He uses this analogy that might have had some truth in their lived experience, in their worship time, of a man who is rich and a man who is poor coming in to the church, probably the assembly of believers in somebody's house. They were probably in house churches. They didn't have a building like we did, maybe. And why is this so wrong as James spells this out? He says, haven't you made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? That phrase, to make distinctions, means to judge that there is a difference. In other words, to judge that there's a superiority difference. And to look at somebody and to say, I will make distinctions. You are superior than you are. And to do so is to split up the congregation into who is more valuable and who is less valuable, and thus make a judgment only God could ever make. Only God could ever make a judgment like that. But we see here that when we show partiality, it's a dangerous thing. Because number one, partiality fails the unity test. It fails the unity test. It makes distinctions. It separates us out into little formations there. And we begin to make up classes of Christians, the upper level Christians and the lower level Christians. But God sees us as sons and daughters. God sees us as valuable and made in His image. And we should see that the assembly as the body of Christ, some are different, but each one is valuable. Some participate more. Some do other things. Some have other gifting, but each one is valuable and worthwhile. And to not see that, he says, we become judges with evil thoughts. There is a time for judgment. But the Bible warns against our superficial, hypocritical, judgmental attitudes. What is the intent when we cast this sort of judgment? Do we tear each other down to get our own way, to feel superior to someone else? And so we should always be asking ourselves to check our intentions, that we are seeing people as God sees them. In today's church, we can make distinctions based on social status or wealth. That is, by the way, why I don't know what any of you give ever. I have never known that. We know what Sarah and I give. When I look at the budget offering, it could be Sarah and I and one other person for all I know. And the rest of you are hanging out, and that's cool. You know, that for all I know, that could be the case. I have never known what people give. Never will I know what people give. And every time it has been proposed to me to ever know, I have thought of this passage, that I will not make distinctions about people, even subconsciously. And if you come and tell me, oh, I gave this much, don't you ever do that to me. Because you will not buy 1 minute out of hell with your donation to a church. Only by the grace of Jesus that sets us all on equal footing. So don't think you will buy privilege with me. Don't think that you will buy any kind of hearing from me with that. You will not. You will not. And I should not do that for you either. In today's church, we can make those sort of distinctions. We make unfair distinctions based on age or seniority. We had an association meeting. I'm going to change the names to protect the guilty. We had an association meeting a long time ago. And there was a little old lady, probably a lovely lady. I mean, let's be honest. But she greeted people at the door of this association meeting as people from other churches that she had never met came into the building. And she shook their hand and said, "Hello, I've been a member of First Baptist for 35 years. Welcome to my church. Come on in." "Well, congratulations. You have lived a long time." And we make distinctions in the other way, of course, as well, too. We say, "Hey, look, you're young. We don't understand. You make all the decisions," right? We make distinctions on appearance, on race, on family, on education. But God calls us higher than that. He calls us higher than that. But it's a pervasive evil. It's built into our makeup. I read a story. Hear my heart when I say this story, of course. I heard a story a long time ago of a pastor who had a mixed race group of kids on a bus trip somewhere. And the pastor noticed as he sat kind of in front that the kids had sort of separated themselves on the bus. They were getting up and moving seats. And they had moved so that there were darker skinned kids on one side of the bus and lighter skinned kids on the other side of the bus. The pastor thought to himself, "This does not look good. I cannot really let this happen." So when they stopped for lunch, they ate lunch together, and the pastor had this kind of harebrained idea. He lined up the kids before they could get on the bus and made them all declare, "I am green." And so the kids would all declare, "I am green," and get on the bus so that all of the green kids had to sit together. And this seemed to work. The pastor, they were going down the road, and the pastor felt pretty good about himself. Until he heard one of the kids say, "All right, light green on this side, dark green on that side." It's kind of built into us, unfortunately, or taught to us, to make distinctions and separations between ourselves. And part of the reason why this is so nefarious is because the devil would love for us to subdivide us as many times as we can. And I'm speaking from Franklin County, very Anglo county, and Gray Summit, a very Anglo city, but listen, I want to tell you today that there is no black church and there is no white church, but there is just the church bought with the blood of Jesus. That's it. That's it. And we remedy this problem by reminding ourselves of the gospel. That's a theme you're going to hear, by the way. That we remind ourselves by the gospel that Jesus has died to rescue all people, that the mission to tell all people is in front of us so that they can find Jesus and hope in Jesus. He came to die for sin, not skin. And that's a problem every race, every nationality, every social status has. Our job today is not to win as many rich people, as many white people, as many young people as possible, but to declare the gospel to all sorts of people because they are made in the image of God and they need to know that there is hope in Jesus' name for a home in heaven. And the church remains united when we keep the mission in front of us. When we keep that mission in front of us, that our job is to reach all sorts of people, all kinds of people. The church isn't us versus them, but rather it's a rescue mission for all people, big and small. Look at verse 5 with me. God is saying that James is saying God typically uses the poor instead of the rich. He's not saying that the poor people are better than the rich people, but pointing out that their judgment of them was wrong. They had elevated these rich folks, evidently, and it was the wrong judgment call. They had passed over the poor folks when God doesn't. And oftentimes it is the rich in that context that we're abusing them and abusing the church and abusing the name of God. So what is this communicating? What was the funny thing about the word translated partiality or favoritism? We need to know what that word means today, because I think that can be misused. In the original language, it means something like to judge or accept according to the face. According to the face. To judge someone according to the face. And so while they were busy judging by outward appearance, they didn't realize, number two, that partiality fails the heart test. It fails the heart test. You know, God is not very impressed with outward appearance. If you read the Bible very long, we think of King David, who was chosen to be the king after Saul of all of Israel, but he was a little, unimpressive shepherd boy. You'll remember the story, maybe you will, that the prophet Samuel went to Jesse, and Jesse trotted out his big, tall, handsome, probably cat students, older brothers, and the prophet Samuel said, "Yes, awesome, that looks like a king. They have all the markings of a king. They look so like somebody I should exalt and I should appreciate." But God said, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." We should, of all people, be people majoring on valuing heart over outward things. Have you noticed that we live in such a shallow, superficial society that we make strange people famous because of how they look or what they have done? But we should be better. It's like what Bilbo from The Hobbit wrote in his poem. You got to get some of these sometimes, if I'm going to be your pastor. He said, "All that is gold, rather, does not glitter. Not all those who wander are lost. The old that is strong does not wither. Deep roots are not reached by the frost. From the ashes of fire will be woken. A light from the shadows shall spring. Renewed shall be blade that was broken." It's so good. You got to read it. Come on. You got to read these books. "The crownless again shall be king." That was a poem about a character named Aragorn, who, when we are introduced to him in the books, he's a dirty old vagabond in a pub, but he has a great destiny. And I won't spoil the book, because you need to read them, all right? Okay, you need to read them. You need to read the Bible first, then Lord of the Rings, okay? I had a friend named Zach in grade school. And Zach had a birthday party every year, extravagant birthday parties, right? With Power Rangers and Pokemon and all these good things that we liked in the late 90s, right? Zach threw a party, I remember, one year, and invited basically the whole class, and I went to that. And what Zach did is he took all of the popular kids in class, and the popular kids would stay upstairs. I'm not sure how he pulled this off, but I remember it very distinctly. All the popular kids got upstairs with bags of Doritos and the good sodas and all this stuff. And all the not-so-popular kids were downstairs in the basement with RC Cola and Mountain Thunder and all this stuff. So there I was in the basement, thinking, what is Zach's deal? I'm not sure I like Zach anymore. I'm not sure he's a good guy. And you know what is the truth? The popular kids didn't like him any better anyway. He had really burned his valuable friendships that day. And he had elevated folks that were not going to treat him any better at the end of the day. They were going to eat their Doritos, and they were going to eat their on-brand Mountain Dew, and then they were going to treat him exactly the same way, because he had judged according to external things and not the heart. And as Christians, we need to be heart people, not face people. And again, we are reminded of the gospel. The people that God chooses for his service are not the most famous or beautiful or rich, but God's people are simply those that love him, are committed to him. Let's stop lifting up and exalting terrible people. Can we do that? Can we make a decision to kind of go against the wind of our culture and stop elevating people that are awful? but in a lighter note, we oftentimes elevate a young, popular preacher or a popular worship leader, and we put them on a pedestal, and all of a sudden we give them a microphone to reach hundreds of thousands. And in recent years, as we've seen, when pressure hits or lifestyle changes or the winds of time change, many of them have turned from their faith. And we have to look and get honest and say, maybe we have pedestaled people that look cool and sing cool and do all these things. And we go, look, this is like last week, right? Look, we're cool now. We're cool. We got it figured out. And then they go, none of this really meant anything to me. Now I'm gonna break out into the secular career. What happened? We're left holding the bag. Are the witness of Christ is not any better because of it. What kind of person? I want to do a heart check for us today. I just want us to ask this question. Think about this with me in your mind's eye. What kind of person? What type of individual? Not a specific individual, but generally, if they walk through that door and they walk through these double doors and they came and sat by you in the pew, what kind of person would make you uncomfortable to sit in the pew with you? Not an individual you think, Zach would make me uncomfortable. And no. What kind of person? An older person, a younger person, a richer person, a poorer person. I'm just talking here, a person of this race or of that race, of this nationality or that nationality. Let the Holy Spirit answer that question to you. But I want to tell you, the church is not a museum for saints. It's a hospital for the broken. It's a rescue station. And we should be excited, not on guard, excited when people come in through these doors. And we should be excited when they don't look like us. Because the gospel of Jesus Christ is bigger than just folks that look like us and dress like us and live where we live and shop where we shop. The gospel is bigger than those things. And I'm going to live my life to be a rescue station for all sorts of people. I heard a story from a church planner this last week. He said that he has an inner city, very urban church plant. And he was he ran into a homeless individual who had breath that would make tears well up in your eyes. You know, he was very unclean, very, very rough in his lifestyle. And he took this individual to lunch at McDonald's. And they sat down and he was trying to preach the gospel to this guy over, you know, a Big Mac or two, right? And all of a sudden his phone rings and he answers the phone and he goes, well, I don't know, maybe I've lost this guy here because now I'm talking. It's his mama. And they let that conversation go, and the guy is trying to relate to his mama what they're doing over McDonald's. And then the homeless man, he takes his phone and he says, here, my mom wants to talk to you. And as the church planner, he put the phone up to his ear, he heard the voice of a little old lady say, thank you for preaching to my boy. Thank you for preaching to my boy. And what he relayed to us as a part of his church's mission is that he realized that day that everybody that he ran into is somebody's little boy or somebody's little girl. And I haven't lived very long. I haven't lived through like some of us, the civil rights movement, these things. But I've never seen America divided like this in my lifetime. I've never seen it this hot. I've never seen it where we can't even talk to each other. And so, of all people, the Church of Jesus Christ, those that are called by the name of Jesus, who love their neighbors and pray for those who persecute us, should be the ones to say, that person, I don't like what they say. I don't like how they vote. I don't like what they believe. I don't like how they dress. But that's somebody's little boy or little girl, and that's somebody worthy to be told the gospel that Jesus saves. Look at verse 8 and verse 9. James has a third test for us. This kind of partiality, judging by the face, it breaks the fundamental laws of relationships. He says, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. It's as simple as that. Number 3, partiality fails the love test. It fails the love test. Simply put, the royal law of Scripture is love your neighbor as yourself. You know, I've heard people say this. I just want to dialogue with it really quick. People have said, why does that need to be in Scripture? Isn't that common sense? Don't all religions kind of get around to that? Love your neighbor as yourself. Well, I want to show something to you. I think love your neighbor as yourself requires the right assumptions about the universe and ourselves that I think are unique to the Christian life. First, you need to believe that you are someone worth valuing. That's a hard one for most of us. I wonder if we don't value others because we don't value ourselves. We do treat people how we want to be treated. We do value people as we value ourselves. It's not very much. And so I'm not trying to be like a self-help guru here, but some of us, myself included, we need to get healthy. We need to have a healthy view of ourselves. We need to have a God. We need to look at ourselves like God looks at ourselves. The disciple John was called the disciple whom Jesus loved because he never got over that Jesus loves him. And we should not be over that as well. Jesus loves me. The old song, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. There's a word that Jesus cares for me, that he loves me. We have to have the right value on ourselves by seeing yourself rightly in Christ. Secondly, you need to see your neighbor as someone as valuable as yourself. That's an assumption not everyone is going to make, right? I'm valuable. Yeah, I'm the center of the universe. That guy's scum. That guy's less than me. But he says, love your neighbor as yourself. You are made in the image of God. You need to survive. You need to live. You need to be shared love and hope, and so does your neighbor as well. Thirdly, it requires the desire to live it out, even when it's not practical. That's seen most vividly in Jesus, who was spat on, who was beaten, who was betrayed, and loved his neighbor as himself. A sacrificial love. Some of you would say that you have been typecast before. Oh yeah, he's the dumb guy. He's kind of slow. She's the lazy girl. He's a slacker. He's not going to amount to anything. She's just too irresponsible. It doesn't feel good, does it? It doesn't feel good. And so if others are as valuable as we are, why treat them the same way? Why turn that onto other people? Now, does this mean that we cannot have a special relationship with individuals? Didn't Jesus have 12 disciples, but have 3 that he particularly met with, that he particularly discipled? That's called discipleship. He took James and John and Peter up into the mountain of transfiguration, and the other 9 were down at the bottom of the hill. Would we say of Jesus, you're showing favoritism, you're being unfair, you're doing these things? But what we're seeing here in this text is discrimination based on outward appearance, which creates disunity, it neglects the heart, it fails to love. But this is compatible with the ability, stay with me, to have unique relationships with individuals. When I was in youth ministry, very young in youth ministry, we had youth helpers that were kind of like there to make sure I didn't screw anybody up, which was a good thing. Fair, you know. And one of our youth, his birthday was on a Wednesday night. It fell on a Wednesday night. And Sarah and I got this guy a cake for his birthday that fell on Wednesday night. He was a big youth helper. He was a youth, but he was active in these things. And you would think threw a rock at the Pope or something. You know, I was accused of favoritism and all of these things. Be careful, guys. Be careful, because I know pastors' wives that are so socially isolated from everyone in their church. Because to be friendly towards anyone is some sort of favoritism that they have just isolated them away. And there are even a crowd of 50, 100, 150, 1,000, they are absolutely alone. Absolutely alone. Can't get too close. Can't get too close. I've met pastors with suicidal tendencies, in part because of the impossible standard of being nice to everyone, but not too nice to any one person. It's impossible to do. And so this can get really legalistic really quick. And I want to tell you, you cannot reasonably have the same relationship with every member of this church. If we were half our size, we couldn't have that. It's impossible to do. Neither can a pastor's wife or anyone else. But here's what we can do. We can check our hearts for discrimination, for these kind of arrogant, divisive attitudes that we have, for a lack of love. And God, help us to love people as we love and value ourselves. It means that we need to stretch ourselves to love people that don't look like us, that don't dress like us, that don't talk like us, that don't think like us. And there's a lot of hero worship in our life today. And it's a challenge to us as we look at this scripture. What if Elon Musk, you all know who Elon Musk is? What if Elon Musk walked through these doors? Would we change anything that we do? Would we change our order of service? Would we say, Mr. Musk, please, would you like to come up and would you like to say anything? Mr. Musk, it just so happens this is two offering Sunday, okay? We're going to send the offering plates around a second time. Elon Musk is not even a believer. He's an agnostic. And we're better to carry on and treat him like we would the homeless man who meets in here. To treat him with the same dignity, the same integrity, the same love. And that's my new goal. I'm going to treat everyone like I would Elon Musk. That's what I'm going to do. That's my new goal. And so as we look at this, James ends this section. And after talking about this partiality, he says, whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one part of it has become guilty of it. Remember when we read that? And you think, where did that come from? You often think that when you read James. You go, is he moving to a new subject here? But if you pay attention here, everyone knows that they failed at one point of the law. Go through the Ten Commandments one time. You won't get humbled today? Go through the Ten Commandments and realize that Jesus said each of those begins in the heart. So you may have not had adultery, but when you've looked at a woman with lust in your heart, you've committed adultery in your heart. That you may not have murdered somebody, but you can murder someone in your heart. You can murder someone in your heart today. Maybe that happened this morning, right? And you can murder somebody in your heart. You can disdain somebody so bad, you can resent someone so bad that you've murdered them in your heart. All of us have fallen short. And so why does James said this? I think it's because despite differences in our riches and our looks and our cultures and our families and our age, that makes everything the same, doesn't it? We're all sinners. He said from the sort of bad sinner to the worst bad sinner, all of y'all are guilty of all of it, he says. If you've fallen on one point, you've fallen on all of it. So I don't care how rich you are today. I don't care how poor you are. I don't care how old or how young you are. I don't care how much seniority you grab or how much you don't. All of us are level at the foot of the cross. All of us are sinners saved by grace. The law of God is the great equalizer. There is no distinction, the scripture says. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So what do we do? James says, so speak and so act as those who are judged under the law of liberty. There is no condemnation in Jesus Christ. But our works will still be judged. What will God find? Will he find a heart of partiality, of discrimination? Did we typecast people instead of striving to see them as God sees them? He says, for judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Here's the key. Here's the key. If you hear anything, hear this. Have mercy. Have mercy. Here's the key. Have mercy. Treat people better than they deserve. View people through a lens of mercy. Be charitable. Be caring in the way that you view people. Talk about people better than you think you know them. Lift them up. Be encouraging. Give people the benefit of the doubt. Half of Twitter would be erased if we did that. Give people the benefit of the doubt. Love your neighbor as yourself and repent of all the rest. All the rest. And remember Jesus, who didn't come to die for holy folks, but came to die for sinners destined for hell. He saved them by his blood. While we were yet sinners, he laid down his life. Why? Because of mercy. Because he, listen to me, treated you better than we deserve. And if we're going to be called by the name Christian, if we're going to be his followers, we in turn need to treat people with mercy better than they deserve. Giving them the benefit of the doubt. Loving and having mercy. As we said last week, listening harder than we speak. listening twice as much as we say, and being not quick to anger, but treating others with mercy. Does that sting your heart today as it stings mine? Has the Lord revealed some bitterness and some anger and some sort of prejudice in your heart? I don't mean always the prejudice that we talk about. There are all sorts of types. Our wicked hearts are creative. There's all sorts of ways to be prejudiced. And so I want to ask you, would you invite the Lord to show that to you? And would you cry out to the Lord today in response to Him and say, God, forgive me where I have failed to promote unity by my love, where I failed to judge by the heart and not the face, where I have failed to the love test, to love my neighbor as myself, and I've caused harm because of it. Would you stand with me as we respond? Father, because we know that there is forgiveness and there is hope for every sin at the foot of the cross, that we come to that same cross. Lord, maybe there is one listening here today that doesn't know you as Lord, who cannot say they are a Christian. And Lord, they want to know the hope, the love, the purpose that is found in Christ. Today we know that it's not by our works, but just by simple faith, that we put our trust, our faith in the name of Jesus. Maybe today would be the day that some folks would do that. And Lord, call Him as Lord for the first time so that they can be saved, not for works, but to works, to live different and to be a light to our culture. But Father, I speak also to the Christian here for a long time, the one who is watching online, the one who is here in our presence, Father, who has held a lot of resentment in their heart and a lot of prejudice in their spirit. And Father, I pray for that one, Lord, who was stirred because they could imagine someone who would walk through that door that they would rather them not. A type of person, a type of individual that they'd rather not be in our midst. But Father, help us to be a rescue station. Help us, Lord, to be a rescue operation for all of the broken and all of the hurting. And Father, would you do this work in us to make us better, to make us more like Jesus? Would you help us to repent today and humble our hearts before you? And Lord, would you receive all the glory and the honor for it? We pray these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Let's respond to Him today. If you're here today or you're watching here today and the Lord has stirred some decision upon your heart, I'd invite you to text DECISION to 636-742-1011. 636-742-1011. If the Lord is stirring something in your heart and in your life. We pray today for those who are wrestling with quarantines, things of that nature. We pray again for our medical staff. Don't forget our quarterly business meeting this Wednesday, and other things happening and being planned throughout the year. We will get you more information on soon. So let's pray, and Sarah is going to sing us out. Father, We love you. We thank you again for this day, for the ability for many of us to be here. We do pray for those who had a miss today. We pray, Lord, for their health and for their wellness, Lord. We pray, Lord, their symptoms, if they're experiencing symptoms, are very mild. Lord, we thank you when we hear of stories where things have gone very well, Lord. But we know that there are some who struggle. And Lord, we do pray for our medical staff who are just working with a high infection rate. And Lord, we pray for them. We pray for our schools, Lord. Some of them shutting down on certain days in order to just try to get on the other end of this high infection rate. Many teachers, many students. Lord, we lift them up to you. We pray for them, Lord, that there would be healing, and we would see just the decline of that wave that we're seeing, so that we can carry on with life and do things as you would have us to do them. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to be your hands and feet. And as we're sent out today, you would give someone in our life to love, and somebody that is somebody's little boy or somebody's little girl, that we would love like Jesus loved them. We'd share the gospel with them. Lord, help us to do that as we're sent out to our mission field. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing together.